book that we really push. That's the living word of God. And I'm grateful to be here this morning. You know, I used to store 2 tons of marijuana where I stored these Gideon testimonies today. Now, that's not my testimony. Dwayne can vouch for that. That's a testimony of Arturo Laredo from Mexico. You see, Arturo had a little store not too far from the Texas border, the Texas-Mexican border, and it was very strategically located that the cartel came in and said, hey, we see you're not using that storage room in the back that much. We'll pay you $3,000 U.S. Money every time you let us accumulate 2 tons of marijuana in there to ship across the border. Well, Arturo thought that sounded like a pretty good deal. That's a lot of money. And all they were going to do was use his room. And they did that 2 or 3 times over several months until the immigration police showed up, handcuffed him, and took him to jail. Arturo ended up serving about 5 years, I think it was, in a Mexican prison where we have these facility testaments. Same. This is a testament used like in Randolph County Jail for the guys that are a little bigger, and you don't have to have a magnifying glass to read them like these. But Arturo got one of those when he was in jail, and he said he opened the book of Hebrews. He started reading the first chapter where it talks about in diverse manners in different places. You know, the God of our fathers spoke through the prophets and on and on. And I thought, that's not a verse that would lead me to God. But there's a lot of verses that touch people's hearts, different verses for different people. And he said that gave him the desire to know more about God. So he began to seek. You know, God's word says, ask him, you know, we will see him and seek and find. And he sought and he found. He found God's love in that testament. He realized that there was a plan for his life. And he said during that 5 years, he not only gave his life to Christ, but he assisted a chaplain there in the prison. When he got out, God led him back to that same building, helped him set up a legitimate business, and today he's a Gideon in Mexico, and that's why he's storing these testaments in his storeroom, is because the guys come and get these testaments when they're going to do a distribution, and he's now storing that instead of marijuana. The Gideons is a worldwide ministry. It's not about Gideon's, it's about God's word. It's about our partnership, you and I. Last year we handed out almost 92 million testaments and Bibles around the world. 2 out of 3 of those were provided by a congregation like this in a church. Without the church, this ministry wouldn't be near us. And it's not only the financial part, but your prayer support. Makes a lot of things happen, as you'll see in some of these testimonies today. I was privileged to go to International Convention this summer. It was in Indianapolis. There were over Gideons from over 100 countries represented there. And I saw something there that stuck with me. Every person that got up and spoke had a real urgency about winning people to Christ while we still had time left. We're living in a world where ISIS is chopping off heads and drowning people in cages, and our police right here on our streets in the United States are being ambushed, and there's drug and crime and all kinds of, you know, the political system's about like it used to be, and worse. There's just a lot of problems in our country. And we had a guy get up from India and said, we have the same problems in India you have in the United States. And I thought, nah. He hadn't been here very long. But then he said, we have a real drug problem in India. And I thought, well, that's kind of surprising. And he said, and we have a teen pregnancy problem in India. That really surprised me. He said, we have the LGBT movement. And that shocked me. But the one that really shocked me was he ended up saying, we abort on an average of 10,000 babies a year in India. I thought, this is a country that believes their ancestors come back as animals. They don't even kill rats that eat their grain because it might be a relative. And I thought, how can they abort 10,000 babies? But what that told me was it's a worldwide problem. It's not a cultural problem. It's not a problem with race. It's a sin problem. And we have the answer for that sin problem. And that's the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if there's a silver, you know, a lot of times they say there's a silver lining in every black cloud. Well, if there's a silver lining in the black cloud of ISIS, it's the hundreds of thousands of refugees that they're driving out of these countries into refugee camps. Because about a year ago, I don't have an Arabic Testament, I haven't gotten one yet, but we've been printing an Arabic Testament for about a year now. The Gideons in Germany have gone into a refugee camp there with 800,000 people. Gideons in Lebanon went in recently into a refugee camp with 900,000 people. 100,000 people of those were out of Syria alone. And they were, for about the second time in Lebanon, they were passing out testaments again. And they ran into a little lady there that was just going around ahead of them, and she was encouraging people, take a testament, take one of these testaments and read it. And so they stopped her after a while, and they said, why are you, you're just shining for the Lord. What has happened in your life? And she said, well, it wasn't always that way. She said, less than a year ago, I was forced to stand outside my home and watch ISIS kill my 14-year-old daughter and my husband, and take my two teenage sons into bondage to be used to, you know, as a human bomb someday. And she said, when I came here, I was filled with bitterness. She said, I had no hope. She said, I was as low as I could go. But she said, I took one of these testaments. I felt like my faith had let me down. It was a faith of violence. And she said, I thought there's got to be something somewhere. And she started reading this testament, and she read about our God of love. And our God of forgiveness, and she gave her life to Jesus Christ, and she was going around encouraging all the people in that refugee camp that she could to take a testament. They were able to give out in a Muslim, highly Muslim refugee camp. They were able to give out 200,000 testaments that week among, you know, 900,000 people. That's a very high rate. For Muslims to take the word of God. So, you know, there is hope. There's hope in God's word. When I was at convention, there was a guy there from Indonesia was telling about a little boy, Sawano, in Indonesia, which is also like 87% Muslim, that his sister got one of these in school. She brought it home and hid it, and he was curious. He thought, you know, I know we'll get in trouble if our parents find out we're reading that thing, but he said, I knew where her hiding place was. And he said, I'd go there at night, but whenever mom and dad wasn't home, he said, I'd get that thing out, and I'd begin to read it. And he said, I couldn't believe there was a God like that that would really care about me enough to send his only son to die for my sins. And he said, I would go every time I was drawn to that Bible constantly. And he said, one night, he said, I went to get it, and there was Dad standing there with the testament in his hand. And he thought, oh man, it's over now. You know, I'm going to get the beating of my life. And then he said, when Dad saw the fright on my face, he said, he began to smile. And he said, I realized that Dad had been going to that secret place as well and had been reading that testament. And long story short, that whole family is a Christian family today, because one testament you provided cost $1.25 that led that Muslim family to Christ. So there's power in God's word. You know, Hebrews tells us it's sharper than a two-edged sword. Paul said it's not bound. You know, he was bound in chains in prison. The word of God is not bound. It's quick and powerful. And then Isaiah tells us it's not going to return void. It's going to prosper wherever we send it. It's going to accomplish what God pleases. So I can go out with confidence when I speak to you, and I can tell you that whatever you gave last year, and however many testaments and Bibles that provided, there were people came to Christ last year because of what you gave and your prayers for this ministry. I got a testimony just in the last 2 weeks that this really touched me. A girl by the name of Carol Copel in Olympia, Washington. Well, she's a girl to me. I'm 73. But she had her first baby, or got pregnant with her first baby, and she said she got toxemia. I wasn't sure what that was. My wife was in the medical field, and I asked her about it. But the mother gets that, and it affects the baby, and Carol said her first child was stillborn at 5 months. And she said the doctor assured her that it was normally only happens with the first child. So encouraged her to go ahead and, you know, have children, try to have children. And she said about a year later, a few months ago, she got pregnant again, and at 5 months she got that toxemia. Well, this time they put her in the hospital. She said, I had to lay on my side for 2 months until that baby got up to 2 pounds where she could, so they could take it. So, it was far enough along that they could safely take it. She said, I laid there day after day, miserable, on my side. But she said, I noticed after a while that this book was laying on the bedstand. And she said, so one day I reached up, and she said, I had never really gone to church or been a Christian, but she said, I realized that was a Bible. And she said, I began to look through it. And she said, the Psalms were short. She said, so I started reading the Psalms. And I've told the guys in jail before, if you're down, I don't care. You pick any one of those 150 Psalms, and it's going to lift you up. You know, you just read one of those and find out. And she said, I read the whole book of Psalms. She said, I reread the book of Psalms. And she said, I started again in the book of Psalms. And she said, every day I took a miserable situation and I got more and more positive about it. She said, I turned my life over to God and said, you know, this is your baby. My life is in your hands. You know, I commit my life to you. And she said, I was unbelievably positive and happy. And she said, the doctors noticed it. And she said, the nurses noticed it. And they thought I was losing my mind. So they brought in a psychologist. And the psychologist said, what is wrong with you? Why are you so, you should be miserable. Why are you so happy laying here day after day on your side with maybe this baby's going to be all right, maybe. How can you be so positive? And she said, all I've been doing is reading God's word and praying. She said he packed up his briefcase and left. She said, I never saw him again. But she said, a week or two later, she said, I had a 1 pound, 15-ounce baby girl. And she said, they tell me that there's all kinds of complications with toxemia babies. But she said, Lindsay didn't have any problems at all. She was a perfect baby. And she said, that wasn't the biggest miracle God worked. She said, the biggest miracle was what God worked in my heart while I was laying there in that bed reading that testimony. And, you know, the Gideon's print on here, they have for years. Please do not remove this from the room. But you know what? We're really secretly kind of happy when they do. Because when they take this home, they're taking the Word of God, which is going to change their lives. And we're probably the only Christian ministry I can think of that advocates theft. and really, in the motel industry, since they kind of banned smoking in most rooms, we've moved up to second. Number two now, items being stolen. It's just towels that are ahead of us now. Getting Bibles. So, praise God that he can use theft to reach people for Christ as well. One thing I have said for I don't know how many years, 40 years probably, when I go out, is you and I are partners in this ministry, and I always stress it. I always stress that. We only have one goal as Gideon's in this ministry, and that's to reach boys and girls, men and women, in 200 countries around the world today that we're in with the Word of God to change those lives. And I want you to know that 100% of what you give, whether it's, I think these are like 2 1/4, the motel Bibles are $5, the testaments are $1. Whatever you give, every penny of that goes into these Bibles and testaments. Because even the guys we have that travel the world and encourage other Gideons and auxiliary around the world, they go at their own expenses. So we can say, you know, you gave $5, you provided a motel Bible. And I wanted to share with you an unusual experience that kind of blessed me. We as Gideons carry what we call a personal workers' testament, where we get a chance. Our wives a lot of times carry these in their purse. Theirs are a bright blue, they tell me. I'm colorblind, but my wife will give them to a boy that carries groceries for her or whatever, any opportunity that they have. And I'm kind of bad about this. Once in a while, I'll give a testament to somebody when we get into a conversation, but I'm not really sharp as I should be on opportunities. And when we were at convention, every day they dismissed you at noon for a couple of hours to go to lunch. Well, they give us three of these to take downtown, and a waitress or somebody on the street, whoever. And I gave a couple to a couple of waitresses in the restaurants. But we got a black Gideon from California. He went downtown. He was on North Meridian Street one day, and he saw this guy leaning in the shade on a building. It was hot in July. He was leaning in the shade over on the street, and so he stopped and asked him. He introduced himself, and it was the guy's name was Jose. He's a Mexican truck driver who lived in Chicago, and he was telling me he had a wife and two kids. And he said, "Well, what are you doing over here?" And he said, "Well," he said, "I'm just resting here in the shade." And I thought, "Why can't I think of a line like this?" And he said, "Well, you thought about where your eternal resting place is going to be." He said, "What if you have an accident in that truck on your way back to Detroit, or down the road someday? What if you have an accident and you're a fatality?" He said, "Have you ever thought about where you're going to go?" And he said, "You know, no." He really hadn't. And he gave me that we had a Spanish testament. I forgot to mention as well in that packet of three. And he gave Jose that Spanish testament. He went to the scripture in the back of it, and Jose said, "I want to know when I die." So he was able to take him through the plan of salvation and lead him to Christ. And I thought, only God could take a black Gideon like Bernard Williams from California, take him to Indianapolis, and lead a Mexican truck driver, from Detroit to the Lord Jesus Christ on North Meridian Street. I mean, what kind of combination is that? But I thought it's being led by the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit opens up that Word of God in people's lives, and we'll just share it with them. And I wanted to close this morning to talk about this situation we live in. World again. We have so much confusion in this country anymore. We got people that claim they don't even know what gender they are. I have a hard time believing that. But you don't know what you're going to run into when you walk into a public restroom anymore. And I'm thinking, we've had so much immorality in this country for so long, it's just become normal. Although every day I'm shocked by something new. New that happens. But years ago I read about the Titanic. I read a book about the Titanic, and I thought, man, this country is kind of like the Titanic. We hit the iceberg back during 9/11, and it got quiet, you know, and people were reflecting on God, and then it lasted about 2 weeks, didn't it? And then the music started, and life was back to normal, and just like on the Titanic, the band started playing again. They went back eating, that thing is nosing down slowly down in the water, and I'm thinking, you know, they perished because they didn't have lifeboats. I thought, we've got lifeboats. We got spiritual lifeboats so we can share with people in this country. And we need to do that in the time that we've got left. And you're helping us. You're helping us do that. You're helping. The people in this country don't have hope. They don't have vision anymore. And Proverbs 29:18 tells us that without vision, people perish. And you and I have the package with the vision and the hope to share with people. I'll end with an example on this. Just this week, I read the testimony of a salesman named Bill last fall. I don't remember exactly what month it was, but in 2016, I'll tell you when it was in April. In April of 2016, we Bibled all of Cincinnati. We called it a Metropolitan Blitz. We did all the hotels, the colleges, the police stations, prisons, everything that we could do down there. Guys came in from the United States and around the United States, and we Bibled Cincinnati. One of the places we replaced the Bibles in was the Quality Inn and Suites in Cincinnati, Ohio. 6 weeks later, a guy named Bill, a salesman named Bill, just saw his testimony the other day. He said he checked into that hotel. He said he was carrying a lot of baggage, and I'm not talking about the suitcase in his hand. His wife of 24 years had just told him before he left home that she was leaving him and divorcing him. And if that wasn't bad enough, she had to tell him about all the affairs she had behind his back in the last 24 years and throw that up to him. And then he said he had four kids, three of which either had drug problems, solicitation problems, or gang problems. His family was falling apart. If that wasn't bad enough, 2 weeks before he checked into the, she told him this, and he checked into the motel when he was on business, he said the company he worked for had told him that they were being bought out by a new company, and he wasn't going to have a job in 4 weeks. So 4 weeks from the time he checked in. And he said, so I opened my suitcase, and he said, I unpacked a pistol I brought. I laid it on the bed because he said I came there with the intent of ending my life. He said I went over and turned the TV up as loud as it'd go. He said I opened the drawer in the nightstand and looked for a pen and pencil or pen and paper to write an apology to the hotel for messing up their room and causing them, you know, a lot of stress. He said there wasn't a pen and a paper in there, but he said I found this. And he said, I looked at that, it said Holy Bible. And he said, I thought, you know, I've never been in church in my life except to go to vacation Bible school a couple of times. And I told somebody the other day, I said, don't ever minimize what you do in vacation Bible school. You may only see that kid once or twice, but I still remember things that I learned in vacation Bible school. He said, I didn't even get married in church. I'd never been in church in my life. But he said that thing was drawing itself to me. He said there was just a magnetism there that I can't explain. And he said, I opened it up, and I went over and turned the TV off. And I sat down on the bed, and he said, I read Matthew. And then I read Mark. And he said, and for some reason, he skipped to John. And he said, as I was reading through John, he said, tears began to flow. He said, I realized that there was somebody that loved me. He said, Jesus Christ, God had sent his only son to die for me. And he said, I committed my life to him right there. He took the Bible, and he went back. He said, 4 weeks later, the company that had bought his company out called him. He said, you no longer have a job as a salesman, but you have a job as a regional manager. And he said, that's just how God blesses. He said, well, when you turn everything over to him. He said, my wife hasn't reconciled with me yet. But he said, I'm working with my four kids, trying to reconcile with them and help them. He said, I'm going to a Bible-believing church. He said, I'm reading my Bible every day. And he said, I now have hope. That's the kind of vision, that's the kind of hope I'm talking about, that you're helping us provide. We're changing lives, and we're changing them for Jesus Christ. And I want to thank you for this time and your service today. I've already thanked Scott. I talked to him on the phone this week. I've never met him, but we had a great conversation. And I want to thank him. I want to thank each one of you for the way you support this ministry, not only with your finances, but with your prayer. And I want to just ask him to. God bless you in your ministry here at Lynn Friends this morning. And thank you again for this time.